Faith family, 239 souls aboard Malaysia Flight 370. What happened? Why? It's like straight out of the TV show Lost. Yet another tragic headline. Mudslides in Washington. Or today, 21 stabbed in Pennsylvania high school. Why? You know, our piano tuner moved from California because he decided that an hour and a half of violent crime news reporting was too much for his wife and two young daughters. So he escaped to Idaho. But we really can't escape the headlines of disaster, of desolation, of wars. It's a barrage, MSN.com, or maybe some of us still read our newspapers. Each story stained with the question, why? It bothers me. And I'm not alone. Not too long ago, I had a call from one of the members of our congregation. It was too much for her. All of the stories, yet another shooting, yet another horrible event, disaster. She was overwhelmed. Does it ever get to you? Do you ever wonder, what is this world coming to? 239 people on their way to Beijing. Why? Were they bad people? Was that it? Were they being punished in some way? Or what about the flip side of that question? If you and I haven't experienced that kind of disaster, what does that mean? Does that mean we're innocent? Or at least less bad? One of the benefits of the faith that you and I share is that God doesn't leave us wondering. Instead, God helps us to deal with tough questions. God helps us to deal with real life. And Jesus addressed the issue of headlines of disaster right straight on. Realize what's at stake here. How you deal with headlines of disaster not only says something about your faith, it affects your faith. Jesus addresses this timely and significant subject for us in Luke 13. It's the first five verses. Now, there were some present at that time who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mixed with their sacrifice. Jesus answered, "Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered this way? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish. Or those 18 who died when the Tower of Siloam fell on them, do you think they were more guilty than all the others living in Jerusalem? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish." This is God's word. We go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, speak to us through the truth. Your word is truth. Amen. We don't know a lot more than Jesus tells us in this section about this event with Pilate and the Galileans. Most likely, they wanted to get Jesus' take on this very current day issue. Most likely, especially because of that connection that Jesus had to Galilee. But I mean, it's a headline that is gory. Pilate sent in soldiers to kill Galileans as they were in the temple with their offering. That's horrible. If we were to update that, it reads like a script for NCIS or Bones fanfic. If we were to bring that into this sanctuary rather than that sanctuary, We would have forensics in here determining the blood pattern spatter on your offering plates. Why? How could something like that happen? Then Jesus goes to the next example, which I think is even better, because instead of senseless violence, Jesus is using what we might term as a natural disaster. In the south corner of Jerusalem, the Tower of Siloam fell, claiming 18 victims. Why? Were they bad people? Did they deserve it? Jesus addresses this issue in a fantastic way. He encourages us to consider world events in a very different way. What Jesus wants is for us to change our way of thinking so that we turn to the Lord. Part of the problem is that we don't usually think we have a need to change our way of thinking. We kind of like ourselves the way we are. We're quite justified in the way that we act most of the time. We were born sinful and will struggle against temptation and sin until we exhale for the very last time. But we don't always sense that. We don't always feel that. So Luther was quite correct to say that sinfulness, our sinfulness, is something that needs to be believed more than it is to be felt. And so Jesus really says something quite shocking here. Repent or perish is the name of this section, the title. Shocking us so that we, in encountering any disaster or any world event, change our way of thinking about it in order to receive a spiritual benefit from it. And we can do this when towers in our country fall, or when disasters hit home for those we care about, or for ourselves. It's heavy. In fact, this leads us to the deep thought of the evening. I don't know if you guys are ready for this. Can you handle it? It's been a long day for all of us, right? You ready for the deep thought of the evening? Here it is. If sin in general can cause things like wars, disasters, loss, loneliness, and anxiety, then it's downright scary to consider what our sins would cost us in eternity in hell. And Jesus takes that moment and that tension and he turns it to an incredible focus on God's mercy by telling a parable. Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree, planted it in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit on it, but did not find any. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, "For 3 years now, I have been coming back to look for fruit on this fig tree and haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it use up the soil?" "Sir," the man said, "leave it alone for one more year, and I'll dig around it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit next year, fine. If not, then cut it down." What amazing patience of the gardener. Yet another year he gives it. Granted, if the tree eventually doesn't change, it will be cut down, but the gardener is doing everything possible for the care of that tree. He's willing to spend more time, more energy, showing the value of that tree in doing everything. In fact, he increases the amount of TLC that he gives that tree. He wants nothing bad to happen to that tree. And that picture of the gracious action of the gardener is very meaningful for us. Because this is how Jesus wants us to change our way of thinking in world events or headlines of disaster. Instead of reading on MSN and saying, how could a loving God allow something like that? Instead, I can change my way of thinking, and so can you, to, wow, how patient God has been with me. He hasn't yet cut me down. I'm no better than the people who have experienced that difficulty in their lives, and maybe there's something that I can do to help them. But as for me, and as for today, I can be thankful to God because He has given to me yet another day. Yet another day to turn to the Lord. Yet another day to find whatever sin is in my life and root it out. Yet another day to bask and treasure the forgiveness that God has won and has given to me. Yet another day to serve Him in my life, clothed in the forgiveness that He has won. Yet another day to share with others that God has saved us from death, destruction, and hell, that they too may believe. And that is why the Savior came. And that is what Lent is all about. God's pouring out of His wrath on His own Son in our place. That God's justice on the human race was completely served. And because of this, you and I and all people are forgiven. It changes everything. It changes our perspective. And it's a challenge, it's an exercise, isn't it? To look at those headlines and to go there and to say, wow, how gracious God has been to me. But in that action, really, God is planting each one of us in a garden. In a garden of repentance. The core meaning of repent is to turn to the Lord. That term is usually used for turning from unbelief to belief. But here, all of us, believers, can turn to the Lord in whatever difficult circumstances and whatever things in life happen. And this is something that our kids can help us with. We have a bunch of great kids here today. Maybe you guys can help me out because we're going to do a little trick to remember this exercise of turning to the Lord. Whenever something happens, we can triple T-L. And you kids can help me out here. Triple T-L. Can you kids do it with me? Triple T-L. It takes some practice. Some of you guys are pretty good. Let's do it one more time. Triple T-L, turn to the Lord. And this is something that you kids can do as well as adults. And you kids probably have a great way to remember this if you have ever planted anything in a garden or if you have planted some stuff in your house to get it started. Can you kids raise your hand if you have planted anything? Have you ever planted anything? Isn't that cool? You guys, isn't it cool to see stuff grow? Maybe you have some boxes in your house or maybe in your garden. Have you kids ever noticed that once the plants start getting a little bit higher, they actually start to angle themselves to receive some of those nutrients, that light from the sun? And if you actually watch, sometimes you can watch it like at the beginning of the day, it'll be over here, and then by the end of the day, it's facing the sun over there. You know, kids, and not so young kids, there's something we can learn from that. Because each one of us is planted in a garden. Each one of us is a tree with roots sunk deep into the nutrients of God's word and the assurance of baptism and the blessing of assurance of forgiveness through the Lord's Supper. And each one of us, like those plants, can turn to the sun. Turn to the sun. When life brings to you tremendous blessings and you can turn to the sun in thanksgiving. And when the headlines of disaster read personal to you, you and I can turn to the sun. Triple TL, turn to the Lord. in every challenge, even when, especially when, the garden that you're planted in is filled with difficulty, disappointment, or disaster. Like my sister who was carrying twins, and at 6 months, they were born prematurely. Emergency baptism, less than an hour of life. My sister was devastated. Yet at the double funeral, my sister turned to the Lord. She would later say that she did not know how powerful God's word was. And it helped her, comforted her, and strengthened her more than she could have imagined. Turn to the Lord. Like Mike. Mike, Vietnamese name, Yung, D-U-N-G. You can see why he went for Mike on his name when he came to the U.S. Mike, one of our ESL students, he went to Canada for 6 months, spending time with his brother, and upon his return, he was horrified to find out that his sister had been strangled by her American husband of 28 years. What followed was a full-on four-hour Buddhist funeral with the typical atmosphere filled with chanting, incense, and sadness. I hate these. They feel like failure. So I'm sitting there, and all I can do is pray. I'm praying that the gospel will make more of an impact in more human hearts. I'm praying for Mike. 1 week later, Mike took a cab to our church because he wanted to be there. I talked to him, encouraged him to come to our basics class, and he did. And he was sitting right here at the table. And next to him was Miss Thuy. Miss Thuy was one of the rare anti-Christian Buddhists. Most Buddhists are kind of ambivalent. Oh, all religions are the same. But she used to take pot shots at Christianity while I was helping to translate for her. She was one of a kind. And I just smiled, you know, and was patient and kept witnessing to her. So she finally agreed to go through BIC, a Bible Basics course, and for the third time she was there with Mike. And on the other side was Mr. Day. I used to translate for Mr. Day quite a bit too, 5 miles south of the Boise airport at medium security, where he was finishing up 22 years because he did his wife very similar to what happened to Mike's sister. Only God could set that table. And all three of them turned to the Lord. Miss Thuy would later talk about how she'd noticed such a change in herself because she spends time in the Bible and prays every night. And she was baptized along with those two men on the same day. They all turned to the Lord, even when their garden was filled with difficult circumstances. My dear faith family, some of you are planted in gardens that have had difficult circumstances. Some of you are no strangers to disappointments, loss, heartache, or sorrow. Even your presence here tonight or listening online, you are turning to the Lord. My dear faith family, please continue to turn to the Lord even in and especially in difficult circumstances. It was in a garden next to a tree that sin first entered this world, and it was on a tree where Jesus suffered for the sins of the whole world. And through faith in Jesus, each one of us is a green tree planted and fertilized by our loving gardener through the Word to bear fruit for Him, not only to survive but to thrive in your garden of turning to the Lord.